أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد، الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد، ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. ثم أما بعد، we are moving on to the phrase or the ayah, the second ayah of Surah Al-Ikhlas, Allahu Samad. We're going to first look at a basic definition of As-Samad. As-Samad al-ay al-kafi. As-Samad is the one who is enough. Alladhi yarji'una ilayhi idha ihtajuhu, the one who they return to whenever they have a need of him. Huwa alladhi yakfihim, he is the one who is enough for them. Wa yasuddu hajatihim wa as'ilatahum alladhi yasmiduna ilayhi, and he is the one who fulfills all of their needs and their questions, answers all of their questions, the ones that they attribute to him or turn to him with عند الحاجة, at the time of need. هذا معنى الصمد. This is the meaning of صمد في اللغة. صمد إليه أي توجه إليه. And linguistically speaking, when you use the word صمد as a verb, it means to turn attention towards someone. وطلب منه الحاجة, or to demand from them the fulfillment of a need. المصمود إليه هو السيد. المتوجه إليه. المصمود is the word مصمود is actually what صمد implies, is the one to whom people turn in time of need. Another meaning, so that's one meaning I'd like you to remember, صمد, one you turn to in time of need. The second meaning, صمد إليه أي قصده. The second verbal meaning is when you make someone your goal, that you aspire to reach them, or you aspire to please them, or you aspire to attain them, etc., etc. When you attribute someone as your goal, they become a samad. So Allah is saying that He is the one we turn to in need, and He's also calling Himself the ultimate goal. He is the goal of what we do. And of course, this is one of the reasons this is called Suratul Ikhlas, because sincerity, ikhlas, is when we do things and the goal of it is always Allah Azza wa Jal. So that's included in the meaning of a samad. والصمد أيضا الغني الذي ليس فوقه أحد. One of the meanings of صمد also is the one who is not in need of anyone else, and no one can overpower them or be above them in status or in any attribute. الذي لا عيب فيه, the one who has no blemishes or no faults in him. من الرجال الذي ليس فوقه أحد. It's used also for, in Arabic literature, it's used for a person also, the one who cannot be overcome, meaning can't be overcome in battle, you can't outdo them in business or in their leadership or in their eloquence, then they're also called a fixture, a samad. Okay, so this is from a linguistic point of view. Additionally, Mufassirun comment, a samad implies عظيم الجلالة. That's one thing, that he's incredible and great in terms of his glory. الدائم الخالد, he's the everlasting. المقصود لقضاء الحاجات, we talked about that, the one who is turned to fulfill needs. This is important now. شيء صمد, the word صمد is used as an adjective also, something that is صمد. مصمت لا جوف فيه أو جوف له. It is referred to as something that is solid with no holes or emptiness inside, something that is through and through pure one thing, like a pure brick of gold could be samad, or a boulder with no possibility of any air or water getting in could also be called, an attribute of it could be samad, meaning something absolute and concrete without any flaw, right? That's one of the meanings. And this meaning is important to appreciate because we give Allah Azza wa Jal names. And a name is like the shell, it's the outside. But then Allah Azza wa Jal actually manifests and fulfills every one of the names we give Him. And He fulfills them in the absolute sense. Is it possible that you give someone a name like noble? That's what you call them on the outside, but on the inside they're really not that noble. It's possible, right? You call someone powerful, but on the inside there's still weakness. It's possible. But when we call Allah any name, now because He is As-Samad, He fulfills that name in the absolute sense. Which is why I gave you that three distinctions earlier on. This is part of now As-Samad. Grammatically speaking, Allahu As-Samad plays a very interesting role in the surah. One grammatical explanation of Allahu As-Samad is that it is al-badal, it is a replacement of the original subject of the sentence, Allah. Meaning, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ أَحَدْ. It's replacing the mubtada, the original mubtada, and this is badal also. Okay. In other words, Allah the Absolute is the only one for which there can be no second. So it's further explaining that first sentence. This is tafsir of the first ayah by the second ayah. You know? This is one way it's understood. The other, the way it's understood is that it's going further from where it began and it's repeating the word Allah again because Allah is giving Himself descriptions that the Arabs who talked about Allah did not give Him. They would also say Allah created, they would also say Allah is merciful. What they wouldn't say is Ahad or Samad. So he's mentioning Allah, Ahad, Allah, As-Samad. And As-Samad has Alif Lam in it, which is for absolute istighraq. You know, it's absolutely, in no way, shape or form is there anything left in his, you know, in the word Samad. And the basic meaning of Samad that gets repeated by Mufassirun over and over again, in addition to what we just discussed, the one who everyone needs, and needs no one himself. That is As-Samad. One of the interesting commentaries by Al-Biqa'i rahimahullah in his tafsir Nazm al-Durar fi tanasub al-ayati was-suwar, commenting on the previous surah, which was the previous surah? Surah Lahab. Surah Lahab talked about a person who thinks he needs no one. Everybody needs him because he was the treasurer. Who are we talking about? Abu Lahab. And Allah is even, after he's done with, now you should know, the only one that is actually As-Samad is Allah Azza wa Jal. So there's this contrast. Well, now that his filthy, self-absorbed concept, because he was self-absorbed, his ilah was himself. He worshipped himself. He didn't even worship any other religion. And you have to remember what he said when the messenger invited him to the religion. You know, there's one time he cursed the messenger himself, we reminded ourselves. تَبَّلَّكْ أَلِي هَذَا جَمَعْتَنَا. May you be cursed, may you be destroyed, did you gather us for this? But this other time he cursed the religion. And when he cursed the religion, what was his criticism? تَبَّلْ لِهَذَا الدِّينِ أَنْ أَكُونَ سَوَاءَ. You know, لِهَؤُلَاء, I will become equal to these people? You want me to accept that religion? Where I will have an equal? Because he thinks he has no equal. Now Allah is teaching us the only one who has no equal is He. He's the only one absolute and He's the only one that is Ahad. Now we get to the logical conclusion. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. There are several things to note here, we'll go through them one by one. The first thing to note here, what is the connection between the previous ayah and Allah saying, He did not give birth to anyone, He didn't father anyone, nor is He fathered Himself, nor is He, the old English term, He didn't beget, nor was He begotten. And I'm using was carefully, because Allah doesn't say, لَا يَلِدُ وَلَا يُولَدُ. لَا would have been present tense. He does not beget, He is not begotten. Allah used lam. And lam forces the meaning of a verb to the past tense. It forces, so I'm translating, He did not beget, He did not father, nor was He fathered. So the first thing we have to figure out is the benefit of the past tense in this ayah. Why use the past tense? Why not say He does not father, and He is not fathered? Why not? Well, the latter makes logical sense. The fact, lam yulad, He wasn't born of anyone, makes sense because birth happens in the past. So that makes sense. But why not protect shirk from the future too by saying لا يلد. He does not give birth. Well, one of the problems with that would have been if you say He does not give birth, that doesn't necessarily negate that He did not give. He did not father. So that leaves room for shirk in the past. Leaves room for shirk in the past. That's one thing. The second thing is we've already said أحد and الصمد. Which means already there's not going to be anyone comparable. Having a child, what does it do? A human being begets a human being. A cat gives birth to a cat. You know, a dog to a dog. An animal gives birth to an equal, to someone of the same species. We've already established he can't have a second. That's not possible for him. And this attribution of Allah having ma'adallah a son, like the Christian community or some segments of the Jewish community, or Allah having daughters like some segments of the mushrikun who said that He took angels as daughters. These attributes were not made of the present or the future. Where were these allegations made from? Of the past. Isa alayhi salam, Uzair alayhi salam, the angels. All of these concepts are relegated to the past. One of the benefits of this past tense is Allah is addressing the falsehoods of the religions that already occurred, and in it, like Abu Bakr al-Baqillani actually commenting on Lam Yalid said, in it there's a miracle of the Qur'an in regards to its predictions. There will be no other religion that claims that God has children that will ever take hold on the earth, like which religions already took hold? Christianity at the heart of it, right? think of other religions that give a, you know, have a concept of God where he gives birth to another. All of them are relegated to what? Pre-Islam. Pretty much all of them pre-Islam. So now here, Allah Azza wa Jal addresses that with the problem that already occurs, the problem that already exists in the people, which is that he already had a child. So now in the Quran, for example, walad Allah, mentioned in the past, and they say that Allah has begotten a son. Then Allah Azza wa Jal says, ja'alu abna'an lillah. They took sons for Allah. Qalu takhadha Allahu waladan. Similarly, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, he says, anna yakunu lahu walad wa lam takun lahu sahiba. How can he have a son when he doesn't even have an associate, meaning a spouse? And the word spouse, one word for that is sahiba, another is kufu, and that's coming in the surah. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. That's coming in this surah. But then what I wanted to bring to your attention is something that is not often overlooked when we study لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. It's very clear to a Muslim. Allah Azza wa Jal does not share attributes with his creation. Giving birth, having a child, or being born himself means you have a beginning and an end. When you're born, you will also die. And when you were born, which means you didn't exist at some point. And that takes away from Godhood itself, from divinity itself. So we never attribute those things to Allah. That's very simple. But that's when we talk about Allah Azza wa Jal. But doing this kind of shirk also has a psychological disease, you can call it a disease of the heart, if you want to use spiritual terms, associated with it. And I want to bring that to light. What is the disease of the heart? Not the disease of the mind, but of the heart that is associated with saying that Allah has a son. What comes with that? Look, I'll give you a worldly example. Imagine that you got a job, and the boss is really strict. But the manager under the boss is your cousin. And he likes you. Okay, so the boss is strict, but the manager is a cool guy. And he's your cousin, you hang out with him, and he's good with you. Okay, so when you slack off at work, what are you hoping for? Even if you get in trouble, who's going to come in the way? Your cousin's going to come in and say, look, this guy's with me. He's okay. Even if the boss is strict, the manager will deal with it. I don't have to deal with it. But I'm really not talking about a manager or your cousin. I'm talking about why people do shirk. One of the core psychological reasons people do shirk. They figure Allah will exact justice. He created me, he gave me. I'm going to have to answer for the things he gave me. I don't know if I want to do that. But if he has a son, or he has someone he loves, and I make sure I make them happy, I don't have to make him happy, I just have to make them happy, then what's going to happen on the Day of Judgment? If he comes after me, who's going to come in between? No. I got these guys. They're with me. It's okay. Let them slide. Right? That is the psychology of shirk. Now, the previous ayah said, the one who everyone should turn to is as-samad. What does it mean? The one who everyone turns to? The one who everyone, part of the meaning, everyone turns to? And Allah is saying, if you only should be turning to me, there's no need for you to give me a son and a daughter. There's no need for you to put anyone in between. Why did the mushrikun put idols in between? Why? Because they will make a good case before Allah. That's what they will do. Set someone up in between you and Allah. And by the way, even the Muslims who commit shirk, who go and worship graves, and you know, make dua to people that have passed away, why do they do that? Because they have haram businesses. They know they're doing really bad stuff. So they can't fess up to Allah. So what do? Let's set up someone in between. I'm going to donate like 50% of my liquor store earnings to this, to this grave over here, or this whatever temple. And then this guy, hopefully, will make a good case with me. For me. You know, that's the psychology of shirk. So because Allah used the word as-samad for him, there's no base left now. You can't turn to anyone other than Allah because he is as-samad. He's the absolute one to be turned to. And so this is a logical continuity. This removes from the people the need to attribute such things to Allah Azza wa Jal. So now we come to the final ayah, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. Now if he doesn't give birth and he's not begotten himself, the word kufu in Arabic is used for spouse, but more than that, interestingly in Arabic literature, kufu is also used for your enemy that's equal to you in battle. Like two guys that are equally good in a fight, like the younger guys don't hear no Ken and Ryu, right? So if you're equally good, then kufu. And it's also used in marriage. I don't know why they made the parallel, but it tells you a lot about Arab marriages back in the day, I guess. But What it is when someone is comparable to you, toe-to-toe with you, in modern expression, toe-to-toe with you, someone who is on par with you, comparable to you, has the same skills, has the same status, has the same ranking as yourself, such a person is called kufu. And so you marry someone who is compatible with you, the same as you, the same level of intellect, the same, you know, circle, social circle, etc., etc., so that's such a marriage became you and your kufu. Right? Now this word is used for Allah Azza wa Jal. He says, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا. And he never had any counterpart, anyone that can be compared to him, anyone that could be toe-to-toe with Allah Azza wa Jal. This, all of this, what we're learning here is tafsir of one word. What word? Ahad. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد. When we learn that word ahad, everything else that we're learning in this surah is a consequence of that word. Allahu Samad is a consequence. Lam yalid wa lam yulad is a consequence. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad is also a consequence. But in this, there's something else. Wa taqdimul aham ula. You see, in Arabic grammar, this is why grammar is so, it's a geeky subject to study, but the benefits of it, subhanallah. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad is actually not grammatically the expected sequence. Wa lam yakun ahadun كُفُوًا لَهُ. That is the grammatically expected sequence of the sentence. But Allah rearranged pieces of this sentence. أَحَد is at the end, right? And then لَهُ is in the beginning, and كُفُو is in the middle. The original sequence was going to be, Allah was to be mentioned at the end. The one who is going to be counterparting him was going to be mentioned in the beginning. أَحَد. Now, in this sentence, what's the most important entity? Lahu refers to Allah. Kufu, the counterpart. Ahad, anyone else. So which is the most valuable words? Lahu. And part of Arabic rhetoric, al-aham ula. The most important should, al-awwal. The most important should come first. Allah mentions himself first before he mentions everything else. He says ahad, one of the meanings of ahad is al-awwal also. Not just لَيْسَ لَهُ ثَانِي. أَحَد means for the one for whom there is no second, but also the one that comes first. And even in the sentence, Allah mentions himself first. That's one benefit. The other benefit is اختصاص. It is he who never has a counterpart, meaning everyone other than him will always have a counterpart. You will have a general, there'll be another general. You'll have a king, there'll be another king. You'll have one false god, you'll have another false god. You'll have one rich person, you'll have another rich person. You'll have one planet, another planet, one star, another star. Everything that is in existence will have a kufu. But it is only he that will not. And where did I get that only he? Because lahu is earlier. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَد. Now just finally, inshallah ta'ala, I want to read to you some benefits of this surah that are commented on. I found the commentary of Al-Razi very beneficial in this, so I'm going to share at least some parts of it with you. He says, I want to mention the first one only. أن أول السورة يدل على أنه سبحانه واحد والصمد على أنه كريم رحيم. He says the first part of this surah, make sure we understand that Allah is unique and one. The second part, Allahu Samad, make sure we understand how gracious and merciful He is. Why is the grace of mercy embedded inside al-Samad? Because everybody turns to Him and He fulfills what they need. لأنه يصمد إليه يكون محسنا ولم يلد ولم يولد على أنه غني على الإطلاق. And the fact that he says he did not beget nor is he begotten, make sure we understand that he does not need anyone absolutely at all, and that he is free from all kinds of alterations in this or any kind of a weakness, because having children is a type of weakness. Why is it weakness? Because I will die one day. How will my species continue? For an animal, how will the species continue? By children, by having offspring. For human beings, if you're not worried about the human species, you're at least still worried about your last name or your family, you know? And if you're not worried about it now, when you become 40 or 50, you say, I don't have any children. Nothing, I have nothing to leave behind, right? This is the kind, and this is the thing that the Arabs gave so much importance. And so there's a contrast. One of the things that was said about the messenger that was the most hurtful, Abtar, doesn't have any kids. Doesn't have sons. That can be an insult to the creation. And a compliment to the creation is you have children. And كان له مال وبنين. This is actually an attribute. Wow, he's got money and kids. He's doing well. This was a status symbol in Arab society. But the same thing that is an insult to the messenger, to say that he doesn't have a child or doesn't have a son, etc., etc., would be insulting to the messenger. But to say Allah has would be an insult to Allah Azza wa Jal. It's reversed, right? Because what is the honoring of Allah can never be compared to the honoring of creation. They're two very different standards. And so Allah makes sure we understand the different standards for these two different things, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, this surah, in conclusion, this surah is probably the most important surah for our children to internalize. Not just memorizing, I think all our kids know it, and all of you know it, but to internalize. What does it really mean? What does it really mean practically for me that Allah is Ahad? That He is As-Samad, that He has no beginning and no end, and we talked about the psychology of shirk that is crushed in لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. And then وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا, no counterpart, no one can be compared to Him. So you understand in times of need, in times of difficulty, when you recite وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ, you will remember. All my problems can come from somewhere, but you know Allah can solve them, and there's no one who can create problems when Allah solves them. This is the surah where we learn to completely give ourselves to Allah. Completely give ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a reason sahaba love this surah so much. There's a reason, it protects us from so many things. And the thing I tell you, one of the names of this surah, An-Najat. This is the surah of rescue. It rescues you from depression, from sadness. It rescues you from it. Because now, whenever something happens, you can take your problems to who? Allah. You can take your problems to the police station, you may or may not get an answer. You can take your problems to your physician. You may or may not get results. But there's one place you will get. You always go, you'll always get. You will always get. It removes your problems. And it's najat min al-nar for millions and millions and millions of people who end up doing the worst crime of shirk. This surah comes and protects even the least educated of the Muslims. If they can just learn this surah, they'll be protected from the fire. They'll be protected from that great, that heinous crime of shirk. May Allah protect us and our children from the crime of shirk. May Allah make us internalize the remarkable lessons of this surah. May Allah make us of those who understand the Qur'an, internalize it, remember Allah by means of the Qur'an, and practice it along with the sunnah of His beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim, wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim.